select committee meeting tonight. So the first item on the agenda is the declaration of interest. Does anyone have any declaration of interest in any of the items on the agenda? No?
Chair, can I just make a suggestion? You will notice there's quite a few members of the public here tonight. A lot of them are here to hear about the 82 bus update. So can I propose that we move that to be the next item, followed by the public question time, and then revert back to the original agenda order?
Is that suggesting agreed?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Need to keep them warm and fine.
Can I do the apology just before that? That'll be a few minutes. Any apologies apart from Lindsay Minger and our chair, Eddie Woods? And may I just express our congratulations to Hetty Woods and James Roberts on the birth of their son.
Gabriel.
That's a nice way to start the meeting, eh? Then I've got a series of just specific questions that are just still slightly unclear to me. For example, are all 82 buses now that use the old route? So it's the route straight down into Liverpool 1 being dropped all together. It's a full reversion to the original route. And also, what is the future for the 75, the 80 and the 18A bus? Are they going to be able to continue using Hanover Street because there's still a plan to
some of those.
And that's all my questions for now.
Thanks, Chair. Just responding to the issue about being bolder, in terms of the traffic movements on Hanover Street, one of the fundamental issues that we've got with Hanover Street is, and the reasons why the proposal has been brought forward around just having an inbound bus priority measure from versus towards the bus station, Bradwell Street in that direction, is mainly as a result of the significant traffic movements that need to be accommodated around access and egress from the pedestrian zone. So, access is permitted both via Lord Street and it's also permitted via Church Street as well, and also, you know, where it's Whitechapel. But there's a significant amount of movements that we've got to accommodate coming out of Church Street. We can't remove those traffic movements altogether. There's also a significant amount of loaded and unloaded demands that need to be serviced along that section, kind of the outbound section, if you like, from the bus station towards Lime Street. Some of the discussions that we've had with the bus operators and the Bus Alliance, colleagues at Mersey Travel, has been around the reason for the experimental traffic regulation order is for us to be able to monitor and see how that goes. Now, the initial feedback that we've had from the Bus Alliance has been very positive. They're delighted that we're able to bring forward some forward bus priority. And that's the reason, the experimental order is the reason why we suggested that, because we need to be able to see need to be able to see how the traffic codes, you know, with the restriction, and that will then give buses officers the ability potentially to change that and do it, you know, in a swift manner. So I think Ian Wiggins is here as the team leader from our traffic management team. Maybe we can just hand over to Ian, you can just add and fill in any gaps on, if you're okay with that, Chair, and any influence that might have to do.
Thanks, Andy. Thank you, Chair. Andy's correct in terms of, if you look at Hanover Street in terms of its frontages, there are a number of businesses and properties along the route which have no choice but to be serviced from Hanover Street itself. Also, looking at the links from some of the other side roads that come onto Hanover Street, the likes of Fairhoff Street, Old Street, Fleet Street, Wood Street, Bradwell Street, you've also got access requirements for some of the businesses on Church Street, which can only take place in the rear, for example, down Brooks Alley. We've also got access that needs to be maintained to Quakers Meeting House and back of the VPC, Radio Merseyside, from School Way itself. All of those movements still need to be maintained in one way or another. And the simple way, the most effective way that we felt that could be managed and allow us to enforce it effectively would be to bring in a robust restriction that would only permit, for example, buses and taxis from the Lewis's direction down to Bradwell Street, and allow the other access arrangements to come, perhaps, for example, from the Duke Street direction. And in that way, we can tease out the traffic that doesn't need to be in there, but still allow the traffic that has legitimate means of access at various times of day or throughout the day. The more different users we allow through any restriction will make it extremely difficult for us to enforce, will basically mean that we're allowing almost as many vehicles back through as currently happens. So we feel that the way we can restrict it and still allow buses to go back into that area would be to introduce an audit in one direction. The details of that in terms of, does it need to be 24-hour, does it need to be time limited for bus operational hours, is still under discussion with the Bus Alliance. And we've put together a series of meetings in the diary for the new year to talk through that in detail with a view to getting something on the ground via an experimental order that can be tested, monitored, tweaked if necessary to support potentially putting other bus services back in as soon as possible. And we're looking to align the timing for that with the bus registration timetable, and they can typically do that in January, in April, in July, and then later on in September, October. So, sort of looking towards those time frames, we're anticipating we could potentially get something on the ground for April, with fair winds and with everyone's support. And that can be as robust as we need it to be. And then we can look to relax any times of operation of that restriction if necessary as the experiment progresses. Just in terms of the details about what specific bus services the Bus Alliance will return to Hanover Street, that is still up for negotiation, and we are moving in positive directions. You've given a strong indication the 82 can go back to how it used to operate in both directions. searching officers that we can maintain and retain our services along that corridor moving forward.
Thank you. Any other questions?
James, I want to make a quick comment, just to reassure members that we are working quite closely with Mersey Travel and the Bus Alliance, and public transport in particular. Buses are a priority for us to keep our city well saved and to promote active travel and public transport.
So, in terms of the 75, the 80, the 88, those things are still up for discussion. We're not exactly sure what the future holds for them. We think every 82 service is going to stick to the original route. I did have a few questions submitted before the press release came out on Monday, so some of these have been kind of addressed, but just to confirm, the 82D and the 86D, is really their days are numbered by the fact that the plan works to launch.
That's something that we need to work through finally with the Bus Alliance, because until we've got exact clarity from them based on what we're coming back with around the restriction on Hanover Street and its timing, only then will they confirm exactly what's happening with some of these services. So potentially some of the services might be able to go around Lime Street and come back into Queensbury in another direction. That again is something that we're waiting on the Bus Alliance to be able to confirm. And to be fair to them, they want to know exactly what the timings are. We've talked to them and given them the report that came from AECOM. We looked at this independently for us. But equally, they're waiting now on the timings that we're going to come back with in terms of, is it appropriate to have a 24-hour restriction in that location where buses aren't running between the hours of 2, 3, 4, 5 and more. So again, that's something that we're working through. We're working to have a look at exactly how the implications are coming together.
Thank you very much. I did just have a few more questions here being directly addressed. So, looking a little bit more widely now, are there any additional bus priority measures planned around the city to improve the movement of buses around the city? Are there any plans to reduce traffic in the city centre? And can you confirm that any changes to bus services in the future will be properly consulted on?
In terms of bus priority, this is moving on to the stage. In terms of the consultation on bus services, that's not for the City Council to comment on. That's a matter for colleagues over at Mersey Travel, so I'm glad to defer to those colleagues to be able to respond to that question. I can't recall any further questions, Councillor Crone, apologies.
Oh yeah, and is there a plan to reduce traffic in the city centre?
The entire city centre connectivity programme is targeted towards doing just that. All of the pieces that fit together that make up city centre connectivity are effectively designed to make the city centre a better place for pedestrians and cyclists to be able to navigate the roads and the services.
Thank you
very much,
Councillor Smith.
Just to, as a cabinet member,
actually met with the group. I was invited to a meeting, but unfortunately wasn't able to attend, but have been in communication with key members of the group and keeping them informed too.
In terms of passing the petition, there is a process of going through committee services, and I think that's the best route
but
to
Chair,
me.
But, Chair, just the point, I mean, the councillor here said that she'd been in touch with us, and she goes, and she has not been
okay, can I just come in on this point?
No,
we cannot accept the petitions. You have to go through committee services so they can log them, and then you get an acknowledgement of the petition.
There's 10,000 more online.
As I've said, you have to go through to committee services and submit your petition through there, so it's, and that's the process. Thank you.
Yesterday,
before the deadline.
I just come in there. He did do it properly. No one is disputing the fact that he submitted it on time. However, the question, some of the questions can, are going to be answered because they have personal information in them which cannot be shared in public. The other things on his email were more like comments, not questions.
Obviously the elected members.
Absolutely, but I've got a time commitment that I've got to stick to because obviously people want to
well,
I've
so
I've also got to be reasonable in terms of allowing people they say there is a process as ever, and all I'm trying to do is just follow that process. If it's wrong, then let's change that, and we'll look at that. Councillor Crone and then Councillor
Tom. What we're getting now is inconsistency.
Yeah.
Thanks, Chair. I'd like to start by completely agreeing with Councillor Simic. I do think we should accept the petition, and I love the idea of having a citizens' assembly type approach to solving these big issues in the city. But actually, I just want to point out that I feel like the council has kind of shot themselves in the foot with this, because actually, people have come here campaigning for the 82 to be returned to its old route. And the news is the 82 is going to return to its old route. So this should have been quite a celebratory meeting where we should all be on the same page. But as it is, because people's questions that they've taken the time to submit have all been answered with a stop response referring to another report, which actually doesn't cover the specifics of all the questions. We've created a negative, toxic environment that didn't need to exist. So just for future reference, when people take the time to engage with the democratic process, send us in questions to try and participate in the functioning of our council, let's just do them courtesy of really good responses, full responses, honest responses, and then when we say we're being transparent, it won't sound quite.
Councillor Bob.
Now, I think one of the confusing things is that the front of every piece of paper that the council brings out in terms of select committee says this is a public committee meeting. If they actually said it's a meeting held in public, which is completely different, because otherwise the message goes out, come to the meeting, well then I want something because I want to say something. So she wants to say something, and now it's like, well, we'll have to take that or not. So if we put out, I'm just making a suggestion here, if we put out with every select committee a paragraph that says, this is how you can get your voice heard, not at these and the system, but also let's remember that we've got a cabinet member who can go around the city, who can listen to people, as you've been saying before. We've got ward councillors. I've done loads and loads of consultation in the wards on all sorts of issues. You pull them together. At the moment, it feels like this is the only place to come and get listened to. It's actually not the right place to come and get listened to. This is the scrutiny committee. So it's really confusing for people. So I think in the middle of the city conversation, which we're going through at the minute, I think what's really key is if all of you want to put in, look, we need a better system to engage with the council, yeah, because the systems aren't clear enough. One committee says one thing, one committee says another. And as part of that conversation, we can say, how are we as councillors listening to the people that we serve in the city? And then it's nice to
say,
and then and that may be one of the issues as well. And then people start to know what they can do. I've had meetings with 40, 50 people in the room talking about one issue. We had officers that have come out, we had a flag tipping in, you came out to that, we had a massive flag tipping in the area. People were really, really upset about it and getting really ill with it. We got everybody together, we had big meetings, we came up with a smash and bash and moved on. It's where it's a city-wide thing, so you've got buses that go from one end of the city to another, and people feel they're not getting listened to, then they need to know where they go to get listened to. So can we put, this is a meeting held in public, it's a select committee meeting, have something on there about the select committee. If you want to be heard as a member of the public, please we can go through these routes, nice and clear on every single one.
Can I just say something else about this campaign?
I've got that lady that at the back just had her hand up for about 5 minutes. I'll let you come in, then I'm going to move on with the meeting. Thank you.
This
that's why I'm saying we go with that. But in terms of that gentleman, I'll let our committee clerk come back in that and just explain exactly what the issue is so we can fully understand.
Some of the correspondence
received
from the gentleman was not appropriate to be.
My name's Ray, use my name, please.
Sorry, Ray. Was it appropriate to put, I was in the public domain. A lot of it was comments, and Ray also asked for, gave a time scale for a written response to the issues as well. So that, you know, that wasn't tonight. So they are, it won't be ignored, it will be, because issues and questions will be dealt with. But he has asked for a written response, and that could not be compiled in the 2 days before the meeting. So it won't be dismissed or, let's say, he will get a response as he's asked for. But it's quite involved what he's asked for.
It's a very involved topic.
It is a full question. So, and I think, you know, as the clerk was saying, we are trying to respond to them in full and within the tagline that he's himself set for as well. So hopefully that should be satisfactory. Councillor Corbett.
Just one thing that we're trying to do. One thing we're trying to do in the city as well is come up with a city plan. So it's not just the council, it's the police, it's the fire guys, it's the health service. It's trying to work together. And I think while we're looking at all of that, it would be really helpful if people could actually have bothered to come to a committee meeting, come up with some suggestions about how we engage properly with residents and with businesses and with everybody else in the city, because now's the time to do it. Yes, there's an assembly, there's all sorts of ways to do it, but if you could work out, actually it'd be great to have a think about this and feed that in, because they feed it in through city plan, city conversations, so you can either feed it into your ward councillors, you can feed it into committee clerks, so you feed it to committee clerks, you can do a little, please have a think about doing it this way. I've been to several committees, I've got some ideas here, have a discussion about it amongst yourselves. Because we make decisions, well, we don't make decisions actually, we're scrutinising the decisions that the cabinet's making. But we've got to listen to you, because you are the ones that are using the buses, for example. So feed that in, otherwise we're losing all that wisdom, making bad decisions or half discussed decisions.
Excuse me, that she will take your details and then help you through the process of submitting the petition as well, if that's okay.
So just to to say that. I asked for a written response. I did. But there was more to it than that. I wanted this thing to be... I wanted Andy Barr, for example, to mention several of the things that were listed in my memorandum. Hardly any of them were mentioned. I'll take it you probably haven't read it, have you, Andy? Andy? Where's Andy?
Have you finished?
I've finished. Well, where's Andy?
Andy's sitting right here, listen.
He's not answering, and that's what made me think he left the room.
No, no, he is still there. Councillor Tom Crone.
Chance to do that because we're in the middle of all of that, so please just have a think about it.